Proverbs chapter 5.
Becomes poor, but the hand of the diligent makes rich. He who gathers in summer is a wise son. He who speaks in harvest is a son who causes shame.
Okay. Please, thank you for that. We get the reading from King James Bible. Please.
It is written, he that gathereth in summer is a wise son, but he that reapeth in harvest is a son that causes
verse
shame.
Verse 4.
Poor that dealeth with slack hand, but the hand of the diligent maketh rich.
He becometh poor that dealeth with a slack hand.
But the hand of the diligent maketh rich.
I just want us to spend a few minutes on that verse. He becometh poor that dealeth with a slack hand. This is the word of God. And many of us are thinking about going to the country. Going to the country is not for the lazy, but for the people who are slack, and so that for the people who sleep late in the morning. The word of God says that we should go to the ants and be wise. Okay? We have to be hardworking. Right? So that we do not we do not bring God's name in this corner. So you go to the country and you are struggling because you are not hardworking, you are bringing this corner to God's name. Okay? That's why it says here that he becometh poor that dealeth with a slack hand. Alright? And then he continues to say in verse 5, he that gathereth in summer is a wise son. He that gathereth in summer is a what?
He's
a wise son. But he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that causes shame. And so, as we are discussing principles of country living, I know that Babylon trains us to just be robots. You're told do this and you do that and you do. And when the government announces a holiday, we shout, yeah, hooray! We just want to see the home. Because we are taught just follow instruction, not to think for ourselves. Jesuit education does not allow for independent thinking. Jesuit education is one that takes everybody through a conveyor belt so that you think the same, but don't follow instruction. And so when God is inviting you to go into the country, you need to start thinking for yourself and to plan your day, and you have to get up early and get things done. The preparation you have had in the secular system of education has not helped you to work in the country. If you've been trained to be employed, as you know, when you go to an organization, you find things are already arranged. You're told, there is your desk, this is what you're supposed to do, and this is the farthest you can go, and don't be too wise and you're just a robot. However much you may dress, put on suits and nice dresses and have reports, you cannot think for yourself. You're not allowed. But when you're in the country, you have to think on your feet. And so, the countryside, we need to be hardworking and we need to harvest when it's time for harvest. You should not sleep during the time of harvest. Right? So I want us to look a little bit about harvesting, preserving the harvest. One of the greatest challenges you can find in the countryside is preserving the harvest. And I've told you that in everything that we do in our life, you will find there are lessons in the Bible. about how to go about it. And so how do we preserve our food when you have harvested your food? Because you're going to plant and then you will get a bumper harvest. We planted some tomatoes last year after struggling for a while. I told you guys that when we first moved to the country, I could not plant a tomato. We tried and we failed miserably. It just did not come out. We tried again and we failed. And I was looking at myself as it was with a degree, a university degree, I can't get a tomato to get out of the ground. You know, and I realized that I needed a different kind of education. So finally, we, after struggling, we managed to get a lot of tomatoes. And then we realized we could finish. They were ripening every day. We were eating ripe tomatoes from the field. The tomatoes we were picking from the field are the ripe ones. You know, most times people buy the harvest raw tomatoes, still green, and they go to ripen the market or at home. But in the country, you find that you don't need to do that. You just wait until it is ripe, you bury it and cut it and use it. But now they were too much. And then we realized we didn't know what. They are not too much to take to the shop, but they are too much for our own consumption. Because the place where we are not yet ready to do commercial farming. The place is not, it's not big enough. So we can plant food for our own consumption, but sometimes we plant a bit too much. It's not enough to make a business case to send to the market, but then it's again not enough. We give some of our workers, okay, take some tomatoes at home, but they steal a lot. So we realize that we don't know how to preserve tomatoes. And we are still been trying to do some, take some lessons on preservation or special vegetables and tomatoes. So we need to have some, that is something that you have to study. You have to do your research on the different kinds of produce that you will be growing and how to preserve. Alright? Storing food for your family is one of the most prudent actions you can take. No one knows what can and will affect the functioning of society or food distribution. On average, grocery stores hold only a 3-day supply of food, and any disruption of service will prove to be disastrous. With stored food, you eliminate the worry. You remember in 2007, there was a problem with food supply when we had that post-election violence. Food supplies were messed up, some places could not get food. Even M-Pesa, you couldn't get M-Pesa working. Right? So people who were living in the cities in some places had problems. Okay? So you find supermarkets and shops usually maybe have up to 3 days supply. After that, it's gone. I have been buying some organic foods in LDU. And since I think June or May, they don't have organic wheat flour. Not actually, most of the organic things they carry, they are not there. I don't know what happened. Their stores, the shelves are still empty. They don't have most of the organic stuff. Then I realized we need to start doing our own organic food. So we can't rely on the commercial system. What does the spirit of prophet tell us? We are not to place the responsibility of our duty upon others and wait for them to tell us what to do. We cannot depend for counsel upon humanity. The Lord will teach us our duty just as willingly as He will teach somebody else. If we come to Him in faith, He will speak His mysteries to us personally. Our hearts will often burn within us as one draws nigh to commune with us as He did with Enoch. Viola? Alright. So God has given us instructions on what we need to do, and if we are willing, He will teach us what we should be able to do. to avoid conflict and confusion. Here long there will be such a strife and confusion in the cities that those who wish to leave them will not be able. We must be preparing for these issues. Let me tell you, we are still living in the city. This is very true. We will get to a time when you will not be able to leave however much you want. If you have got that small little property that you think you have in the city, there will come a time when you won't be able to sell it. You will just be stuck. You will not be able to leave the city. You will have lost your job. You won't have money to go and buy some land out there. The time to leave is now. Even in this country, it's getting harder and harder to leave the city. Remember in Jerusalem, before the destruction, there was a time Christ had prophesied that when you see this and that happening, do not even go back to your house. Just leave. And those who heeded that instruction, they were safe. But there was that time when it was too late, when the soldiers, the Roman soldiers, had come back the second time and they surrounded the city. At that time, even if you were convinced, now I must leave, you could not leave. And the people that were in Jerusalem perished all. So there is a time. God gives us a time. There is a time that we need to leave. And from what we have been reading, we are 100 years behind schedule. This was written by the servant of the Lord when she was alive. So there will be a time, and I don't know how soon, when it will be too late. And it's too late in different ways. It depends on your circumstance. Perhaps right now you have the best opportunity to make money, financially and otherwise. You may think you don't have money, but I can tell you, you have more money now than you will have next year or next month. Right? So this might be the best time for you to make money. Next time, it will be harder and harder. It is important to start preparing for this issue. Okay? So I want us to look at a story in the Bible about the need to learn how to preserve our food. Why should we preserve food? Let us look at the book of Genesis, chapter 1, and from verse 1 to 7. There's a story there that is told, and I told you that everything that is in the Bible is there for a reason. If you can start looking at the Bible, there is nothing that was thrown in there for no reason. God made sure these stories were recorded, these events were recorded for our benefit. So you might just look at it as some story of Pharaoh and Joseph, but there is a reason for that story.
Okay.
king, and then cause one of his servants to come and interpret that dream. You know that the next time that a dream was given to a heathen king was Nebuchadnezzar. And at that time, God showed Nebuchadnezzar what was going to happen in the future. A prophecy that extends up to our time today was given to a heathen king. And here, we have God giving a dream to Pharaoh. You should ask yourself why. It was just not just a dream, an occasional dream. Yes, it happened, they had the 7 years of plenty and the 7 years of famine, but that dream has a spiritual significance. We've been having the years of plenty, even plenty on spiritual issues. And now, we can see the 7 years of famine have begun. You will not have... There is a verse that says that there shall be a famine, and not a famine for food. But a famine for what? Can somebody read that verse?
Region. All the days come, saith the Lord God, that I will send famine in the land, not famine of bread, nor thirst for water, but for hearing the word of the Lord.
Famine for hearing the word of the Lord. The guys in Kisi Church experienced famine. The guys in Glory Land the other day experienced famine. You will not hear this word of the Lord in our convention. The famine has started. And guys are still asleep. I asked you at the beginning of this conference, do you know that the abomination of desolation is already starting in the holy place? And you guys thought I was joking. We are experiencing the 7 years of famine. And that is why we need to preserve the harvest. Not just of the literal food you're going to have in the countryside, but we are harvesting right now. And you need to learn to preserve the harvest that you are getting right now in this country. I don't know if you'll be able to have another conference like this. I told you that this is an illegal meeting. Okay, so let's see what happened. So, Joseph was called upon to interpret. Verse 28. This is the thing which I have spoken unto Pharaoh. What God is about to do, he sheweth unto who? Unto Pharaoh. That which happened was something that God was about to do. Behold, there come 7 years of great plenty throughout all the land of Egypt. So there was going to be plenty. And there shall arise after them 7 years of famine, and all the plenty shall be forgotten in the land of Egypt. And the famine shall consume the land, and the plenty shall not be known in the land by reason of that famine following, for it shall be very grievous. And so there we see a lesson in food preservation. There is a literal... There is a literal application, but there is also a spiritual application. So I want you to go and meditate on the spiritual application. I won't give it to you right now. All I can tell you is that today we are harvesting. So do not let the words that you hear in this conference drop, because if you don't harvest again next time. And don't be slack. Don't be a son who is not wife. And let us look at the literal application. We need to preserve our harvest. We need to learn how to preserve our harvest. And remember the principle we learned in the morning, thou shalt not steal. So we are not going to use the conventional Babylonian systems of food preservation, because some of those preservation methods are toxic. And I'm not here as an expert on food preservation. I'm just here to provoke your mind that one of the lessons that we need to study. I know you guys have been doing your investigations on natural remedies. We need to find natural methods of food preservation so that we can share them amongst ourselves and learn how to preserve food. Okay? Why should we preserve food? God gave Joseph the interpretation of Pharaoh's dream that if he obeyed the counsel of God, the people will be fed during the 7 years of plenty as well as in the 7 years of famine. God promises to take us from among the heathen or the world into our own land. He promises to give us a new heart and to put his spirit within us so that we may walk in his statutes, keep his judgments, and do them. So God is always providing guidance to his children if we can obey him. God gave Pharaoh the advice on what to do in the light of what was coming. And that was to prepare and store the harvest. And because Pharaoh, a heathen king, who had never even heard about the God of heaven, obeyed and even appointed Joseph to be in charge. What a shame that we who spend days in God's house will hesitate and be dilly-dally when God gives us counsel that is for our safety. If a heathen king will obey immediately and change a prisoner to be a prime minister, what faith did Pharaoh have? How much faith did he have? And today we are being told to get out of the cities to the country, and we are still asking God, how? How are we going to be? We are still having questions. But here is a heathen king who obeyed, and because Pharaoh obeyed, he saved the Egyptians. And he also saved God's people, the family of Joseph. So when we obey God and follow his statutes and his commandments, we shall be saved. Okay, so I would like us to look. Today we are having trouble. And then something else that we have been warned is that there is going to be famine. Jesus Christ also predicted famine. Matthew 24, verse 7 and 8. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be what? There shall be what? Famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. Jesus Christ himself predicted that in the last days there shall be famine. We have seen what happened with Egypt. There were 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of famine. Now we are seeing Christ is warning us that the end time application of that event is in our time, that there is going to be famine. So we need to learn how to preserve our food. And so the second principle we learned there, did Jesus tell us that before his coming there will be famine? Yes, he warned his disciples. Various things happen in the world during the time of destruction. Alright? And so we see that verse that we just read there. Okay? Now, the other thing, could our lack of obedience in the last days cause us to bring famine upon ourselves? Could our lack of obedience cause us to bring famine upon ourselves? Yes. If we don't obey, I told you, if Pharaoh had not obeyed, the Egyptians will have died of hunger. And if we don't obey what Christ has given us as a warning, then we will have that problem. So unless we prepare for the no-buy, no-sell decree, by growing and preserving our food, we could be creating a famine for ourselves in that time in which God has warned us before. This means that if you decide to follow Christ and keep the seventh-day Sabbath, you will not be able to buy or sell anything. Right? You will not be able to purchase food, fuel, clothing, or pay for your bills. You will not have car insurance, cell phone, all these things are for the guys in the city, you know? Alright? other thing that requires funds to have. Money will be of no use if you do not have the mark of the beast. Food will be of greater value than money. I told you, you can't keep money. You can have plenty of it, but if there is no food in the shop, it's useless. So we need to prepare to have our own food and to be able to preserve it so that we can be able to stand at that time. Revelation verse 13, chapter 13, verse 15, 17, that is where we get that. I don't want you to say that I say, oh, there's not going to be a time to buy ourselves. It's very clear in the Bible. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead. And that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Okay. This is why God took the Bible and the spirit of prophecy has given us instructions on how to prepare for this time. We have to obey God's instructions, not out of fear, but out of love. Jesus says, if you love me, Christ doesn't want us to suffer necessarily. Let us not cause famines to come upon ourselves because we were not diligent. We didn't obey God's instruction. Okay. The earth has blessings even in her depths for those who have courage and will and perseverance to gather her treasure. Fathers and mothers who possess a piece of land and a comfortable home are what? They are what? Kings and queens. He has never left his people without escape. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that he may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come. I think I cut out some part of that verse. Right? God desires that in every place the people shall be taught to use wisely the product that can be easily obtained. Skillful teachers should show the people how to utilize to the very best advantage the products that they can raise or secure in their section of the country. That is the spirit of prophecy. Cancer. Right? We need people to be taught to use wisely the products that can easily be. We should have skill on how to utilize those things to the best of our country so that we can secure them at a time of need. Okay, so let's look at some of the things. I'll just mention a few, but I can't be able to cover all manner of food, so I'll just mention a few grains and vegetables. What's that? That's wheat, but that can represent maize. Barley, rice. So we need to figure out how to preserve the maize or the wheat. That is a traditional granary. You know, traditional granaries are usually above the ground. So you need to have a storage that is above the ground if it's not in your house. Okay. We also can use glass jars to store, especially if you don't have much. You can store them in glass jars so long as they are tightly closed, right? You can also use plastic bags before you put them in guineas. I think there's some companies that sell these plastic bags. Or you can use these drums. Iron drums, or what you call them, these barrels that are usually used for oil. You wash them, they are airtight, you clean them and dry them, you can put your grains in them and close tightly. You can preserve them for some time. But these ones have been used. So long as the grain is completely dry, you can be able to store it for a while. Of course, if you store it when where there are rats, then it's of no use. Because the rats will eat. It eat through. We tried this, but we had some rats came in and went through. And of course, once it gets that perforation, then the weevils will get it. Right? So just make sure that it is completely dry and it is safe from rats. Actually, rats are a menace when you go to the country. Almost every home I know in the country has a rat, unless there is no cat. So that has been a problem, especially for us. It's a rat problem. So because they come from the bush and they prefer to stay near the house where there is food. So a natural deterrent for a rat is a cat. We have been avoiding to keep these domestic animals because cats sometimes can be a source of allergies. But we will have to get a cat this way because they are a menace. They are very destructive, especially when they get into the kitchen at night. So these are the ones that can mess you up with this kind of story. Okay? I know you know I've come to be at a granary with I showed you a grass stack, but it doesn't have to be grass stack. I just gave this as an example because you never know, you might be in a place where you don't have enough money to buy iron sheets, so you can use a grass stack. But you can actually use iron sheets. And it can be done properly so long as you can even do a stone granary so long as it is raised by columns, by pillars. You raise them a pillar maybe half a meter high, and then you have the suspended floor. And then you can store your grains there so that you get rid of away from the termites and those ants that can get it. Right? So I don't know. This is what we can do for grains for now. I don't know if anyone has a comment or question on the storage. I told you storage is an issue. And when you store the grains, make sure they are dry. Right now we are experimenting with neem leaf powder. We've not quite figured out the concentrations, but it can help with storing the grains, and it doesn't affect the quality of the food. So if you are able to access neem leaves and grind them into powder, you can sprinkle on your grain. It can reduce the onset of the infestation of weevils. If you know of any other thing that can help with the storage, with the stored grains to lengthen its days, please, you can.
Thank you. I have another way also that I've seen working with the cereals. You can use Mexican marigold. Do you know that plant? Mm-hmm. Yes? You don't know it? It was some pageant man. But it doesn't affect the grains. Actually, you can ground it. Sometimes I grounded it, and where you placed it, you cannot see weevils. So you can use Mexican marigold, Lantana Camara. So if this is your granary, and the grains are inside there, what do? You can put you can hang even the leaves around the granary from inside. You put the Lantana Camara with the Mexican marigold. If you can have neem, you can also use that. You find that the parasites, the weevils will never attack your grace. That one I've seen, and we thank God for that. Amen?
Amen.
Yes.
Okay, can somebody pass another mic just so that he can be able to respond? Is there another one? Okay, there's a question here.
Another way that has always been used, because these days we get that people will be shelled, like if it is maize, we deshell them and then we keep them in guniyas. Another way that has always been used is the use of wood ash. You sprinkle wood ash on the grains and then you store them. Then another one, this is very new to me, but there are people who have used it and it is working. You take the leaves of thorium, you know thorium, it's outside there, the wild sunflower. You dry it so well and you put it in layers, like you can put it and then you put your maize. After some time again, you again spread it on top of the maize and then you put another,
layer.
Then you put it, as in you put it after ukishamwaga like certain ndoos of maize, unaweka the dried leaves, then unaweka ndoos of maize, una put the dry leaves, and again, finally on top of the gunia, you put it and then unashona tu gunia yako, it is okay. You dry the leaves, then you just put them on top, you don't have to dry them. As long as it is dry, remember that when there is any moisture, it will rot. See you.
Okay, so you have got that. I'm glad you are getting some good suggestions. Please remember we are harvest, we are lazy son.
Really? Okay. When you plant maize and lentils, also beans, after you harvest the beans, you dry, then you heat them. After you heat, you harvest the grain, the seed. So the remainder of the stalk and the leaves, you burn them. The ash is very important, the ash. Another one, like knowing that the right area like this one where you have sisal, you could use sisal. You see when sisal is mature, you cut the straw on top. That stump that remains, once you burn it, you can use the ash. So a mixture of both is usually important, the best for preserving also green grass. No green grass usually come with the weevils from the farm. So with the moment you put it in your house, within a month, it should be last. So, the ash of beans, stock beans, the cover and the stock, plus or singularly the stock of what? Sisal. If you could dry aloe vera, but I don't know if you could get the much aloe vera you need, but sisal one you see it's a big chunk. It will give you enough ash. So the ash is very important. Even if you have heartburn, you also need the ash and you burn it. So it has many uses.
I think even when you are planting, there is a way that you can have to put those... weevils, yeah. So you can find garlic, you can find the garlic, and then you put garlic plus how do you call it? There's something happening, kissy. That in a nuka when jangina, then you shock it.
Can you give her the kissy name?
Motiok. Motiok. Yes, and then it's yes, and then you know, yeah, so you can shock that one plus for almost 1 week, and then you can spray your fields.
You dry?
You know, you can.
You
shock it for 1 week, and then you can spray your crops. When you are planting, yeah. When you are planting.
That is a pesticide, right?
A pesticide, yes. Yeah. And yes, there's a DVD here for how you can preserve your tomatoes, so you can see.
Okay, we were on the side of grains, and I'm sure...
If you can have the cloves and put them in the cereals, they can also do something. As a preservative, yeah.
Clove?
Yeah, the dry clove.
Clove powder.
Clove powder.
We'll change the
mic is not very fast. Fast pass. I hope you are taking notes.
Basically, there is another mechanism to release parasites, these ribbons, and even the rats that invades the granite. You get the, as our brother was telling us, Lantana Kamala and Mexican Marigold, and Kaunda. What you do, you bring green Lantana Kamala and Mexican Marigold. In the evening, you lit the fire around your granary, and then you bring a heap of Lantana Kamala. Then you place it on fire. It will just remove a smoke that will just go around your granary. And basically these weevils, they will not live there. So it is a good method. Before you place your grains into the granary, you just chase them away. Even the rat themselves, they run away because the granary will be filled with rat smoke.
Okay. All right. Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. I want us to look at another crop that we normally, where did it go? Yeah, fruits. Okay? Wherever fruit can be grown in abundance, a liberal supply should be prepared for winter, like canning or drying. Small fruits such as currants, gooseberries, strawberries, raspberries, and blackberries can be grown to advantage in food. What I'm not sure is the actual detail, how long you should boil them, and how you wash them, so that I want to leave that to somebody who might prefer to give us a talk on how to. Yes, you want to help us?
Yeah.
Where is the mic? Somebody is sitting on the mic. Okay.
Yes, I'm over here. I've done a presentation on canning a chia by Eric Osoro. And basically, when you buy the canning machine, it usually comes with an accompanying manual on how you can the different foods that you want to can. Like we did a demonstration on the tomatoes, and when you cans the tomatoes, they can last for like a whole year. So it is something that you can just invest and order the canning appliance from America. Then it will just come with everything, instructions, and all that to start canning up your food.
So when you go into the country, there are things that you need to invest. Not in a good suit or a car. I think those are some of the things that you need to put aside some money so that you can be able to fill up your kitchen. Alright? Actually, I will, in my lecture tomorrow, we will discuss a bit on some of the things you'll have to do when you go to the countryside, the things you need to prepare for, and we will touch on that. But the canning equipment is very important if you can get it. But I believe that with a little research, you can get some simpler methods of canning, because everybody can be able to order stuff from the US. And I believe the information is there. If you are diligent, you can find out how they used to do it. How did the Egyptians preserve their food? How did the Israelites preserve their wine? But Christ says you do not put new wine in old wineskins. They must have had a way of preserving grape juice until it survived up to the next harvest. So that now the new wine has come and they have to find a place to put the old wine, is it? Yeah, so there must be ways of preserving grape juice so that it can last longer.
like I say, for me, that is a big assignment I have, because in the last, this last season, we had a lot of mango in the in our garden. Just, well, we have one mango tree, and it produces over 500 mangoes. And we could not finish eating. We sent some to Nairobi, to friends, but the rest we have to share with the bats. You know, God doesn't waste anything. Yeah, so I don't know. I'm still learning. You know, I have a lot of things to learn. I told you guys that when you go to the country, you are busy. There are so many things you have to learn. So I am visiting my medical missionary course. We have got a farm to work on, and when the fruits are ripe, and you scratch your head and say, how are you going to do this? So that is a lesson I need to learn, how to preserve mangoes. Okay, so preservation is that homework that I'm giving you as a homework. You need to go and learn how to preserve the various things that you want to go and grow, so that the next season they can carry to the next season, and also during the time of trouble, if you have preserved your fruit, you know, like I've learned that honey, if you harvest honey, it should last even 10 years. So long as you don't add water and sugar, because that's what they do in most of the honey you buy from the shop, and preservative, right? But this is the honey lagoon, I know, I just need to harvest it and put it in jars, and I don't have to think about it, right? And of course, you can't have honey if you don't have a big shepherd in a forest, yeah? You have to go to the country, right? And then you have to get honey from the shop. So anyway, that is preservation. It is a homework I'm giving you as an assignment. You have got some ideas from here. Let us share. Maybe you're planning to grow a certain crop. We can have a forum where we can be able to share how to preserve the crop, so that we don't waste the benefits that God has, the produce that God has given us. I think that I will end my presentation there. If there is any more question or comment. A hand at the back. I did mention vegetables, but I think vegetables, it goes without saying. Sun drying, you dry a lot of the, especially the bitter herbs, managus, kinsagas, you know, you can dry them and they can stay for a long time. So vegetables are easy. I don't think they should be such a big deal. Just sun dry them and then keep them in a dry place. You should be able to take care of them, and you can just use them whenever you want to. So I did mention mango vegetables. I assume that it should not be hard. Most of the mamas, they used to preserve vegetables. When you have a bumper harvest during the rainy season, that's when you get a lot of these vegetables growing. You harvest them and just dry them, and then when they are completely removed all the moisture, then you can keep them. Yes?
Actually, what I wanted to comment about is drying of vegetables.
Oh, thank you, please.
Yeah. There's also another method that you can boil them for a few minutes. Then you place them and, in the sun. Then after that, when they are ready, you store them in sand or in plastic bags. Something else is that also on drying is on how there's a way also on drying of fruit. Fruits like grapes, you can just put them under the sun, then you cover them. Then after 2 or 3 days, they are normally ready for use. Yeah, you can also dry bananas and apples by cutting them. Like for bananas, you can quarter them, and also apples, then you dry them under the sun. Also remember, you have to cover them because of maybe these insects which can cause diseases. Yeah, and don't, something else is that for bananas and apples, they may change the color, but it doesn't mean that they are spoiled.
You dry the bananas when you peel them or with their feet?
When you peel them.
You peel them and then you quarter them. You quarter them means you cut them into four. Right.
Yeah. You can also bake them, fry them in the oven.
Okay. If you have the energy. Did somebody need to do something about how to make biogas? Was there something on biogas? Yeah, so then you should be able to operate your gas oven. Very well, if you can find a way to store the biogas so that you can operate your oven and dry your. Thank you very much. It's my prayer that we shall be the wise son who harvests during summer and not the one who sleeps during the harvest time, okay? When you plant your crops, please plant on how you will store your produce. Of course, if it's a commercial crop, then you can plant on how you can sell while there is still time. But plant to have storage so that it can take you through the winter, right? Through the winter for us, through the off-season. So the time when tomatoes are ripe for, these onions are ripe for 200 more in January. This year, tomatoes became extremely expensive. And if you had planted earlier and stored, you would have to spend so much money on buying tomatoes. By the way, a lot of our vegetables and in the market come from Tanzania. You know that? A lot of vegetables that are sold in Kenya come from Tanzania. Onions, green peas, a lot of things are coming from Tanzania because Kenyans, we are so good in our school system. We are not interested in farms. So we are a net importer of food. As we speak. So it's actually going to get worse and worse. And then the other day, the president of Tanzania, I don't know what happened, and they stopped border business. I don't know. I think there's something happened, and there was a serious crisis at the border. So, you know, those kind of issues, conflicts here, one word by a leader can cause commotion. And if you are depending on the market systems for your food, then you can find yourself. And maybe you have a patient you're trying to treat, you can find yourself in a very difficult situation, right? Just trying to be self-dependent. Thank you very much. God bless you as you prepare yourself for a life in the country. Okay. Just sit down in prayer. Continue to guide us as we prepare to get to the country. We pray all these things.